Okay, so today we discuss about introduction about isolator, different types of isolator, in which we discussed the construction and operation of the isolator. Then we'll discuss the introduction about the fuse and also discuss the various terms related to fuse as well as the different types of fuses. Okay, so these are the contents of today's lecture. Okay, so electrical isolator. Okay, isolator is used in the switchyard and substations. Okay, so the basic functions of the isolator. Okay, the basic function of the isolator is to isolate the system or the line, we can say that. Okay, so isolator is installed with a circuit breaker. Okay, and it is a one type of air brake switch. Okay, it is an air brake switch, also operates on no load condition only. So we can operate the isolator in only no load condition. We cannot operate the isolator in the on load condition. Okay, so isolator is an electrical air brake switch which operates on no load conditions only. Okay. So we have a different types of isolators. So basic classification of the isolator is the application based and the placement based. Okay, so on applications based, we can say that it is classified into single brake type isolator, double brake type isolator, pantograph type isolator, as well as the MCB type isolator. So these four classification is based on the application. So on applications basis, it is classified into four category: single brake type, double brake type, pantograph type, and MCB type. Whereas according to the placement basis, it is classified into bus side isolator, transfer bus side isolator, and line side isolator. So at which place it is connected, okay, on the basis of it, it is classified into bus side isolator, transfer bus side isolator, and line side isolator. So mainly it is classified into two categories, that is the application base and the placement base. Okay, which type of application is there? Okay, so according to it, it is single brake type, double brake type, pantograph type, and MCB type. Okay, whereas at which place it is connected? Okay, so on placement base, it is classified into bus side isolator, transfer bus side isolator, and line side isolator. Okay. So bus side isolator, that means the isolator which is directly connected with the main bus. Okay, there are two buses. Okay, one is the main bus and second one is the transfer bus in the switchyard. Okay, so the bus side isolator is defined as the isolator which is directly connected with the main bus. Okay, so the isolator connected in main bus, that is known as the bus side isolator. Okay, that is the main bus. Okay, so one isolator is connected in main bus, that isolator is known as the bus side isolator, because this classification is based on the placement, that means at which place it is connected. So it is connected in the main bus, that's why it is known as the bus side isolator. Okay, second is the line side isolator. Line side isolator, that means the isolator which is situated at line side of any feeder, that is known as the line side isolator. Okay, what do you mean by line side isolator? One isolator which is situated at line side of any feeder, that is known as the line side. So generally we can say that it is connected in the line side of any feeder, that's why it is known as the line side isolator. Under that is the transfer bus side isolator. That means transfer bus side isolator, that means the isolator which is directly connected with the transfer bus. Okay, so the transfer bus isolator is connected in the transfer bus, or we can say that it is connected directly with the transfer bus, that's why it is known as the transfer bus side isolator. Okay, so bus side isolator, that means the isolator which is connected with the main bus. Line side isolator, that means the isolator were connected at the line side of any feeder and transfer bus side isolator. That means the isolator connected with transfer bus. Okay, now another classification is the horizontal brake type, vertical brake type and pantograph type. Okay, so this image shows the vertical brake type isolator. It is also known as the single brake type isolator. Okay, look at this image. Okay, in this image we have a three insulator post. Okay, two insulator post. These are the two insulator posts. This is the one insulator post. This is the second insulator post. And this one is the third insulator post. Okay. So this insulator post and this insulator post, these two insulator posts are fixed. It is not movable type. Okay. Whereas this type of insulator post is of movable type and it is connected with the connecting rod. Okay, so this insulator post is connected with the insulator rod. Okay, okay, on this insulator post the female contact is mounted or placed. Okay, here is the female contact and this female contact is mounted or placed on this insulator post, whereas on this insulator post the male contact, that is the rod. Okay, so this male contact is connected or it is mounted on this insulator post. Okay, and this movable insulator post is connected here. That is the hinged point of this movable insulator post. Okay, so with the help of this movable insulator post we can open or close the male contact with the female contact. Okay, so according to the movement of this moving insulator post the male contact becomes closed as well as the male contact becomes open, but the movement of the male contact is in the upward direction. That means we can say that it is in the vertical position. Okay, this rod, that is the male contact, this rod is connected with the female contacts. Okay, so in right now in this image it is male contact is connected with the female contact, so it is the closed position. Okay, but as soon as this movable insulator post moves, this male contact goes in the upward direction. So in this direction like this. Okay, so what happens as this movable post, we can move in this direction. Okay, this is the hinged point, so it will move from this point. Okay, so from this hinge point if we move this movable insulator post in this direction, then the male contact moves in the upward direction. Okay, so as soon as this male contact becomes moves in the upward direction, the contact between male and female contact becomes open, so it will become the open circuited. Okay, so with the help of this, now how can we move? It is by the motor mechanism or by hand driven. Okay, so by hand driven or by motor mechanism we can move this movable insulator post in this direction. So this male contact goes in the upward direction and the contact becomes open. Okay, so here there is only one brake. Okay, right now it is the closed circuit, but as soon as this contact moves in the upward direction it will break the circuit. Okay, so the movement of this male contact is in the upward direction and there is only one connection to break. Here is the one connection, that is the connection between male contact and female contact. Okay, so as soon as this insulator post moves in this direction, the male contact goes in the upward direction, it disconnects between these two contacts, so these two contacts becomes open circuited. So we can say that the one break occurs between these two contact and this break is of vertical type because the movement of this rod, that is the male contact, movement of this rod is in the vertical condition. So the name is the vertical brake type isolator. That means the rod, that is the male contact, moves in the upward direction. It will break the circuit. That's why the name given is the vertical brake type isolator. And this is the also known as the one brake type isolator. Why it is known as the one brake type isolator? Because there is only one connection between male and female contact. There is no two connection. There is only one connection, that is here. Okay. And this one connection is braked by the movement of this insulator post. So it is only one brake. Only one brake occurs in this isolator. That's why it is known as the single brake type isolator also. Okay. So this isolator is known as the vertical brake type isolator, or we can say that the single brake type isolator. Okay. Now next is the horizontal brake type isolator. It is also known as the double brake type isolator. Okay. Previously vertical brake type. Here is the horizontal brake type. Previously it is single brake type, whereas this one is the double brake type. So now from its name we can say that horizontal brake type isolator, that means the braking process is done horizontally. Okay, and double brake type, that means at two position it will break the circuit, or we can say that it will break. Okay, so there are two connection, and two connections will break in this isolator. So horizontal brake type isolator, that means the movement is horizontally and it will break at two position. That's why the name given, that is the horizontal brake type isolator, or we can say that it is a double brake type isolator. It will break the circuit at two places. Here is the one place and here is the second place. Okay. So we can say that this is the one insulator post. This one is the second insulator post and this one is the third insulator post. Okay. So for three phase, we have a three different post. Okay. So this line is for one phase. This line is for second phase and this line is for third phase. Okay. So this is the one insulator post, second insulator post and third insulator post. Okay. Now one rod is connected on this center insulator post or middle insulator post. Okay. This is the middle insulator post, and on this middle insulator post, one rod is connected, or we can say that on both side of this rod, the male contacts are there. Okay. On both sides. So this is the rod which is mounted on this insulator post, and at this end there is one male contact, at this end there is another male contact. Okay, so we can say that at both ends of this rod the male contacts are there. Okay, and on this insulator post there is a female contact. On this insulator post there is another female contact. Okay, and with the help of the motor mechanism or hand driven, we can move this rod horizontally. Okay, so right now it is in the closed position, but as soon as we move this rod horizontally, it will break the male contacts from the female contacts on both sides. Here it will break the contacts, here it will also break the contacts. Okay, so two brake occurs. That's why it is the name given is the double brake type isolator. And horizontal brake type, that means the operation is done horizontally. Okay, the movement is not vertical, the movement is the horizontal. Okay, so as soon as we move this rod horizontally, it will break the circuit from two places. So it is known as the double brake type isolator. This is the actual double brake type isolator. Okay, so in vertical brake type, the movement of the rod is vertically. That's why it is known as the vertical brake type, and it is the single brake type isolator. Whereas in horizontal brake type isolator, the movement is horizontally and it will break at two position. That's why two break occurs. That so we can say that it is a double break type isolator. Okay, this is the general specification of vertical and horizontal type isolator, whether it is a horizontal type isolator or vertical type isolator, single break type or double break type. Okay, rotating type as per Indian standard 9921 and 1818. Okay, this is the isolator specification. So rotating, that means the moving or the operation occurs, that is the rotating type as per the Indian standard 9921 and 1818. Central rotating type and double break type. Okay, then rotating type single double break consisting of hot dip galvanized channel iron base. Next is the original post type HT insulator. Which type of insulator is used? That is the original post type HT insulator. Copper or copper alloy high pressure heavily tinned contacts. We already discussed that is the male contacts and female contacts. Okay, how it consists? It consists from the copper material or copper alloy high pressure heavily tinned contacts. Okay, so the material used for the male contacts as well as the female contacts. Plated mild steel arcing horns capable of breaking the magnetizing. Okay, with the help of this isolator, the arcing horns are also used to break the magnetization. Okay, so the arcing horns consist from the mild steel plate. Okay, then current complete with the horizontal connecting bar GI pipe as down road. Okay, when the isolator is in closed position, at that time the current passing through the connecting bar of GI pipe. Then coupling and operating handle with locking arrangement in voltages up to and including 33 kV line switchyard. If we talk about the 33 kV line switchyard, operating mechanism, that is the operating handle, coupling and operating handle with locking arrangements up to the voltage level of 33 kV. Current up to and including 1600 amperes manufactured as per IS 9921 and 1818. Okay, the current rating is up to the 1600 ampere. Tilting type, that is the double break rotating type. Okay, double break rotating type, tilting position or which type of tilting, that is the double break rotating type. The base material consists from the iron. Okay, so whatever base of the isolator, that is consist from the iron, and voltage level is the 33 kV. Okay, so this is the specification for single break and double break type, or we can say that the horizontal type and the vertical type isolator. Okay, now next is the vertical pantograph type. Okay, previously we discussed about the vertical, only vertical type isolator. Now this is the vertical pantograph type isolator. Okay, so one modification is that is the pantograph type shape is used in this isolator. So movement is vertical and it is according to the pantograph type. That's why the name is the vertical pantograph type isolator. Okay, this is the solid insulator post. Okay, look at this image. Okay, solid insulator post, and with this solid insulator post, another insulator post is there, that is known as the solid rotary insulator post. Okay, with this solid support insulator, another insulator post is there, and it is known as the solid rotary insulator post. That means it is in the movable condition. Okay, this rotary insulator post is capable to rotate. Okay, and according to the rotation of this insulator post, how this solid rotary insulator post rotate? That is with the help of this operating mechanism. Here the operating mechanism is there. Okay, so with the help of this operating mechanism, We can move this rotary insulator post clockwise or anti-clockwise direction around this solid insulator post. Okay, so as soon as this rotary insulator post moves, according to that the pantograph works. Okay, whether pantograph moves in upward direction or downward direction, that depends on the movement of this rotary insulator post. Okay, so in this image, the connection is already done. That means here is the overhead station bus, or we can say that the overhead conductor that is connected with the pantograph. Okay, when the pantograph is in open condition or fully stretched out condition. Okay, so at that time it connects the bus bar. Okay, but as soon as this solid rotary insulator moves, at that time what happens, this pantograph moves in the downward direction. This is the dotted line, it shows the dotted line. Okay, so this hinged point comes at this point, this hinged point come at this point. Okay, so what happens, this pantograph moves in the downward direction. As soon as this pantograph moves in the downward direction, the connection between the terminal of pantograph and bus bar becomes open. So there is no physical connection between bus bar and pantograph terminal. Okay, so at the base of this pantograph, one terminal is provided to carry out the current when the pantograph is in the closed position. Okay, so this is the vertical pantograph type isolator. This is the actual image of the vertical pantograph type isolator. Okay, so these are the when this rotary insulator moves in, at that time what happens, this vertical pantograph terminal goes in the upward direction and bus bar is connected with the terminal of the pantograph. Okay, so this is the actual vertical, this is the solid insulator post, this is the rotary insulator post. So with the help of this operating mechanism, the rotary insulator post moves, and according to it, the pantograph terminal goes upward and downward direction. These are the hinged point. Okay, this is the one hinged point and this is the second hinged point. Okay, so this is the vertical pantograph type insulator operation. Okay, so no live circuit should be closed or open by isolator operation. As we already discussed, that isolator is a no load device, air brake no load device. So we can say that no live circuit should be closed or open by isolator operation. No arc quenching technique is provided because we are operating this isolator in no load condition. So there is no requirement of arc quenching technique in isolator. It must be operated when there is no chance of current flowing through the circuit. Okay, a complete live closed circuit must not be opened by isolator operation, and also a live circuit must not be closed. Okay, and completed by isolator operation to avoid huge arcing in between the isolator. We should avoid the huge arcing between isolator contacts with the help of, so we have to operate the isolator in a no load condition. Isolator must be open after circuit breaker is open, and this must be closed before circuit breaker is closed. That is the interlocking we already discussed in the previous lecture. Then isolator must be open. So first we have to operate the circuit breaker, and then after we have to open the isolator. And for closing, we have to close the isolator and then we have to close the circuit breaker. Okay, isolator can be operated by hand locally as well as by motor mechanism or remote position, from the remote position. Okay, so we can operate it manually as well as the motor mechanism is also provided. Motorized operation arrangement cost more compared to the hand operation, hence decision must be taken before choosing an isolator for system with a hand operated or motor operated economically optimum for the system. So obviously the motor mechanism operation is the costlier compared to the hand operated mechanism. So it will be used as per the requirement. For voltages up to the 145 kV system, hand operated isolators are used, whereas for higher voltage system like 245 or 420 kV and above, motorized isolators are used. These are the specification given. So up to 145 kV hand operated isolators are used, and above 245 or more than 245 kV the motorized isolator, motor mechanism isolators are used. Okay, this vertical pantograph isolator is also used for high voltage system. Okay, that is the vertical single break type and horizontal double break type isolators are used for lower voltages, but the vertical pantograph type isolator is used for high voltage system. Okay, so these are the isolator. Isolator is a air brake no load devices. It will used to break the circuit, or we can say that it will isolate the system in no load condition. We cannot operate the isolator in the full load condition. Okay, on the basis of placement, we can say that the bus isolator, line isolator and transfer bus isolator, whereas on the basis of application we can say it is a vertical isolator, horizontal isolator and vertical pantograph type isolator. Another is also the MCB type isolator. Okay, so this is the basics of the isolator. Now we'll discuss about the fuse. So it was originally invented by Edison in 1880. Okay, in which year it was invented? It was invented in the 1880 by the Edison. Okay, that is the original invention. Okay, it is the weakest link in the electrical circuit. Okay, we should not say that it is the link, that is, we should say that it is the weakest link in the electrical circuit. Okay, not the strongest link. If we say that it is the strongest link in the electrical circuit, then it will not melt. And it will not melt, that means it will damage the system, it will not protect the system. Okay, so we can say that it is the weakest link in the electrical circuit. It prevents overheating of the electrical circuit and appliances, having simple design and simple working. If we want to protect the simple design and simple working appliances, then it prevents against the overheating of the circuits. It is used for overload or short circuit protection in medium voltage up to the 600 volt. So up to 600 volt voltage level, this fuse protect the circuit against the overload as well as against the short circuit. But recently the HRC fuses have been developed for applications up to the 66 kV HV distribution. The most preferable fuses up to the 66 kV HV distribution system, that is the HRC fuses. Now the basic terms related to the fuse. Okay, that is the first is the fusing element. Okay, how can we define the fusing element? The conductor or wire connected between two terminal of the fuse is known as fusing element. Okay, whatever wire or conductor that is connected between the two terminal of the fuse, on the right side of the terminal, on left side of terminal, and in between these two, one conductor or wire is connected, that is known as the fusing element. The duty of fusing element is to carry normal current safely. Understood this sentence? The duty of fusing element is to carry normal current safely without heating. But when normal working current is exceeded, it should rapidly heat up to melting point. This is the main function of the fusing element. It must to carry normal current safely. Okay, when normal condition is there, the current must carry by the fusing element. Okay, without heating, there should no heating in the elements. Okay, but as soon as the short circuit or overload occurs, at that time it should exceed or it should rapidly heat up to the melting point. And as soon as it reaches to the melting point, it will melt and breaks the circuit. Okay, so this is the main purpose of the fusing element. Okay, so we have a different metal used as a fusing element, and for the different metal elements we have a melting point, that is in the Fahrenheit, and specific resistance. Okay, so if we talk about the aluminium, the melting point, if we use the aluminium as a fusing element, then the melting point in Fahrenheit of aluminium material, that is the 240, whereas the specific resistance of aluminium is 2.86 ohm. Okay, whereas the tin, lead, zinc, silver and copper. Okay, so copper has a melting point of 2000 Fahrenheit. So if we compare the aluminium and copper, the aluminium has the lower melting point, whereas the copper has the higher melting point in Fahrenheit. And if we compare the specific resistance, the aluminium is 2.86, whereas the copper is 1.72. Next is the minimum fusing current. Okay, so minimum fusing current is, it is the minimum value of current at which fusing element melts. Okay, equation, how can we find? I minimum is equal to K under root D cube. Okay, this is the formula to find the minimum fusing current. Okay, so if we assume that the one fuse is connected in the circuit, okay, and current is flowing through the circuit through this fuse or fusing element, up to which point the current will flow through the fusing element? Up to the minimum fusing current. Okay, but as soon as the minimum fusing current goes high, it will break the circuit. Okay, so minimum fusing current, it is the minimum value of current at which fusing element melts. It is not the maximum value of current, it is the minimum. Okay, सबसे कम करंट पे जो फ्यूजिंग एलिमेंट मेल्ट होगा उसे क्या कहेंगे? मिनिमम फ्यूजिंग करंट. ओके, दैट्स व्हाई इट इज द मिनिमम वैल्यू ऑफ करंट एट विच फ्यूजिंग एलिमेंट मेल्स. आई मिनिमम इज इक्वल टू के अंडर रूट डी क्यूब, वेयर के इज द कॉन्स्टेंट फॉर कॉन्स्टेंट एंड इट हैज अ वैल्यू, डिफरेंट वैल्यू फॉर डिफरेंट मटेरियल. सो कॉपर हैज अ कॉन्स्टेंट के इज इक्वल टू 2530, whereas lead has 304.6. so for different material the value of K constant is different. Okay, this is the minimum fusing current. D is the diameter of the conductor. Next is the factors affecting the minimum fusing current. So minimum fusing current, that means the minimum current required to melt the fusing element. Now on which factor the minimum fusing current depends? Okay, so first is the material of the element. The which type of material is used as a fusing element, whether it is of aluminium or tin or lead or copper, etc. So according to the material used for fusing element, so this factor affects the minimum fusing current, because the different material has the different melting temperature. Okay, so as the different material has different melting temperature, that means this factor affects the minimum fusing current. So which type of material is used for fusing element, that factor also depends. Okay, so on this factor minimum fusing current depends. Then the length of element, how long the element is used. Okay, so R is equal to rho L by A. So R is equal to rho L by A, that means the resistance depends on length of conductor or element. So if the length increases, the resistance increases and conductivity reduces. So length of minimum fusing current also depends on minimum fusing current. Okay, then the diameter of element. Okay, previously we see the equation that I minimum is equal to K under root D cube. D is the diameter of the conductor. Okay, so the minimum fusing current also depends on diameter of fusing element. Then the size and location of terminal. Which type of size of terminal is used, as well as at which position or location of terminal. Okay. If corrosion occurs in the terminal, then it will affect the minimum fusing current. Okay. Then the type of enclosure. Okay. If it is a fully enclosed type, then it will protect the terminal against the corrosion, or we can say that against the atmospheric effect. So type of enclosure also affects the minimum fusing current. Okay. Then construction of elements, whether it is of stranded type or single type. Okay. So which type of element construction is there, whether it is of stranded type or single type, that will also affect the minimum fusing current. So these are the factor which affects the minimum fusing current: material of element, length of element, diameter of element, size and location of terminal, type of enclosure, and construction of element, whether it is stranded or single. Next is the current rating of fusing element. Okay, there is one difference between the minimum fusing current and current rating of fusing element. Okay, so the definition of current rating of fusing element is, it is that value of current at which the fusing element can normally carry current without melting. Okay, current rating of fusing element is always less than the minimum fusing current. Understood the definition? Current rating of fusing element is that value of current at which the fusing element can normally carry current without melting. Okay, so it will continuously allow the current through it. That is the current rating. So if current rating is 6 ampere, so up to 6 ampere it will allow the current, but above this 6 ampere current it will melt. Okay, so this is the current rating, and this current rating is always less than the minimum fusing current. Okay, now next is the fusing factor. What is the definition of fusing factor? The ratio of minimum fusing current to the current rating of fusing element is known as fusing factor. So in the formula form, we can write fusing factor is equal to minimum fusing current divided by current rating of fusing element. Okay, now from this formula, here what happens? Current rating is always less than the minimum fusing current. Current rating is always less than the minimum fusing current. And the formula of fusing factor is minimum fusing current divided by current rating of fusing element. So what is the value of fusing factor here? Current rating is always less than the minimum fusing current. So what is the value of fusing factor generally? What is the value of fusing factor? Current rating is always less than the minimum fusing current. So it is always greater than 1, because minimum fusing current is higher than the current rating. Okay, so fusing factor is always greater than 1. Significance of fusing factor is that it readily states the minimum current at which the fusing element will melt. Okay, now next is the prospective current. It is defined as the RMS value of alternating current or direct current which would flow in a circuit immediately following a fuse when a short circuit occurs, assuming that fuse has been replaced by a link of negligible resistance. Okay, now we assume that one circuit, and in this one circuit the fuse is connected or fusing element is connected. Okay, now the short circuit occurs. So generally what happens when short circuit occurs, at that time the fusing element will melt and current becomes zero. But in this situation, when short circuit occurs, at that time we have to imagine, or we have to assume, that the fusing element is replaced by a link of negligible resistance. When short circuit occurs at that time, what we have to assume? We have to assume that fusing element is replaced by a link of negligible resistance. Okay, so when short circuit occurs at that time, the RMS value of alternating current that is flowing through the fusing element. Okay, when short circuit occurs and we are assuming that the fuse is replaced by a link of negligible resistance, at that time the RMS value of alternating current or direct current which is flowing in the circuit is known as a prospective current. Okay, एक सर्किट है, उस सर्किट में शॉर्ट सर्किट होता है. जब शॉर्ट सर्किट होता है तो हम क्या एज्यूम करते हैं? फ्यूज की जगह पे एक निग्लिजिबल रेजिस्टेंस की लिंक लगा देते हैं. उस टाइम जो सर्किट में से अल्टरनेटिंग करंट फ्लो होता है उसकी आरएमएस वैल्यू और डायरेक्ट वैल्यू ऑफ करंट, दैट इज नोन एज द प्रोस्पेक्टिव करंट. Okay, this is the image of fusing melting time and arcing time. Okay, this dotted curve shows the arcing current, this solid curve shows the melting current. Okay, and the melting time, that is the time required to melt the fusing element. Okay, and after that, at this melting point, the time required to make the current zero, that is known as the arcing time. Okay, that is the melting time and arcing times. Okay, and this dotted curve shows the current without fusing fusing element. Okay, dotted curve shows the current without fusing element. So when fusing element is not there at that time, short circuit occurs at that time, this is the waveform of the current. So melting or pre-arcing time, that is the, it is the time taken from fault occurring to the cutoff. Okay, here melting time, here, so here that position the fault occurs, and after that, so the time between the occurrence of the fault and melting of the fuse, that is known as the melting time. So the time taken from fault occurrence to the cutoff. Okay, then second is the arcing time, that is the time between instant of arc initiation to the instant of arc being extinguished. Okay, so here what happens at this point, that is the melting point. So at that melting point the arc is initiated, and at this point the arc is being extinguished, so it is known as the arcing time. Or we can say it is the time between cutoff to the final current zero, and total operating time, that is the sum of pre-arcing time and arcing time. So this is the total time. So melting time, that is also known as the pre-arcing time and arcing time. So if we combine these two time, it is the total time. Okay, desirable characteristics of fuse elements. So its melting point must be less, so it melts at less temperature. For example, lead material has the less melting temperature. So which type of fusing element we have to use, or which type of fusing element is desirable? So we have to use such type of fusing element which has less melting point. For example, which material? That is the lead. Lead has a less melting point. If the melting point is less, that means the fusing element will melt at less temperature or the low temperature. Second characteristics, its conductivity must be high, so current can easily pass through it, like copper and silver. Okay, if the material resistance is more, then current cannot easily pass through it. Okay, so we have to select such type of fusing element which has a high conductivity. So conductivity is high, that means current can easily pass through it. Next is, it is of such type that atmospheric effect on it should be minimum. The material we have to select is of such type that atmospheric effect must be minimum. It is not zero, but should be minimum. And cost should be less. This is the another characteristics. So we have to select fusing elements such type which has lesser cost. Okay, so these are the desirable characteristics for fusing element. Melting point must be less, conductivity must be high, atmospheric effect should be minimum, and cost should be less. Okay, so today we discuss about introduction about isolator, classification of isolator, vertical type isolator, horizontal type isolator, vertical pantograph type isolator, then introduction about the fuse and different terms related to the fuse. Okay, so up to this point, we'll stop.